Before we start, I want to apologize if the title of this video gave you the wrong idea. The topic I'm discussing is merely a hypothetical. There's no official confirmation of a sequel in the works that we know of as of the date of this upload. This is merely speculation and wishes, and I apologize if the title for this video seemed clickbaity at all. And if you obviously haven't played the game yet, spoiler warning, leave, play the game, finish it, and then come back. That being said, oh, Super Mario Odyssey, how many times have I talked about you and would not stop fanboying over you since your reveal trailer, and yet I'm still enamored with you. The control, the moveset, the levels, the level design, the graphics, the characters and NPCs, the quirky Paper Mario level dialogue, the animations, how expressive every character is, especially Mario, the spectacular highs you present such as the New Donk City Festival, and the finale of the game, the bosses, the soundtrack, the ideas and creativity on display between the world themes and the capture ability. I'd probably still ramble about the game when I'm in my grave in 80 years. I know. It's probably tiresome hearing me dribble on and on about how much I adore this game, but I can't help it. It's done what I've wanted out of 3D Mario for so long since Galaxy, and I've milked my playtime with it tenfold, 100%ed it 3 times now, and I'm in the mood to do it again, to be honest. Though it's easy to note, we're all well past the honeymoon phase of the game. It's fantastic, and one of the best Mario games in a good while, though it's not the most perfect thing to come out as it has a couple grievances and issues that I'll address later. While we're allowed to point at any criticism and issues the game holds, it's clear it is a very popular and critically acclaimed 3D Mario game. It's gotten 5 out of 5 stars, 10 out of 10s, 9 out of 10s. Across the board, the game was critically acclaimed to heaven beyond for how fun and amazing it was. So much so, it got a spot at the Game Awards in 2017. Lost to Breath of the Wild, reasonably so, but still. What's more is it's the best-selling 3D Mario, outclassing Super Mario Galaxy, Super Mario 3D Land, and both versions of Super Mario 64, amassing 14.94 million copies since last June, along with being the second game on the Switch with the highest attach rate. Or third? Maybe? I wouldn't be surprised if Smash Ultimate passed it, but Mario Kart 8 Deluxe has been the highest for a while, but either way, it's within the top 3 best-selling games on the system, and has probably sold a tiny bit over 15 million by now. Mario sells, and people love Odyssey. Given this, would it be difficult to imagine the possibility of a Super Mario Odyssey 2, a sequel to the most successful 3D Mario game? In my humble opinion, seems all but assured. Why am I so confident in the thought is for the reasoning as follows. One keynote is Odyssey's popularity. Like I said, it's the best sold 3D Mario, surpassing Galaxy in sales. Galaxy was in the lead prior, and it's the only 3D Mario game to get a direct sequel. Because millions of people hopped aboard the Odyssey ship when it was brand new, it's reasonable to suspect they'd stick to their guns with Odyssey's formula. The second keynote is a precedent that was set almost 10 years ago. Super Mario Galaxy released in late 2007, but a sequel is announced a year and a half later at E3 2009, with it releasing May of 2010. Super Mario Galaxy 2 came only 2.5 years after Galaxy 1 release, not even 3 years later, and the team decided to make a direct sequel because Galaxy was the hottest Mario game at the time. The developers also had a bunch of leftover ideas from the first game that, because the Wii wouldn't be able to incorporate DLC into its games like its competition, they've decided to create a whole new game with those ideas in mind. There's another game with the exact same scenario, The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild 2. Funnily enough, I went into this past E3 expecting an Odyssey 2, only to forget, oh yeah, there was that other top flagship-selling Switch single-player game that wasn't Mario, the Blue Link, right? And we ended up getting a sequel for that and not the former. The thing with this sequel's creation is Eiji Aonuma outright stated that they had so many ideas from the first Breath of the Wild that they decided to scrap the idea of DLC and just make another based off of them altogether. Exactly how Galaxy 2 came to being. I have no doubt in my mind that just like Mario Galaxy and Breath of the Wild, the Odyssey development staff had loads of ideas left over, even more beyond the unused concepts and artwork that we do know of. Lots of people, for example, were wondering if we'd get more kingdoms in the form of DLC, but the only DLC we got in Odyssey was a really short and quick labo mode, extra costumes, and Luigi's Balloon World. No new kingdoms or such, despite files for a certain island paradise was found on the Odyssey's globe and in promotional material before the game came out. I'm specifically referring to Isle Delfino, and that's only one example. There are tons of costumes that went unused in Odyssey, along with certain characters and themes being cut from the final game as well. Zelda and Mario Galaxy got got sequels due to overflowing ideas, concepts, and creativity from the first games, alongside how popular and successful both games were. Both sequels also used the same game engine as their predecessors, and it wouldn't be wrong for Odyssey to do the same. It's highly reasonable to suspect Odyssey 2 will fall under the same pretenses. When we can expect such a sequel to be announced, I feel is only a matter of time. Originally, I felt this last E3 would have been the time with a spring release window like Galaxy 2, and I thought the gap between Odyssey 1 and 2 would have been the same as Galaxy 1 and 2. When it could be revealed, could be this September in a direct, could be next spring, next year's E3, who knows. I do expect at the latest E3 2020, but I'm keeping a small mindful eye of earlier possibilities, and I could see it release either late 2020 or mid 2021. Just 3 to 3.5 years from Odyssey 1's release seems like a palpable amount of time. I do think it's a valid probability. If I end up being wrong, at least pondering the possibility and ideas in this video would have been fun indeed. So, if a sequel does come, what can we expect from it? What ideas could they make? What ideas do we have? What ideas do I myself have? Well, sit back and get comfy, my lovely, beautiful viewers, because I got lots. For starters, they can easily reuse Odyssey's graphics and gameplay engine multiple times over with no grievances or compromises. Odyssey, in my opinion, still stands as the best-looking Mario game by far, so they can easily get away with using the same engine again, especially if they've done so with Mario Galaxy 2 and Zelda Breath of the Wild 2. Both duologies look fantastic for their respective eras anyways. Both Galaxy games still hold up visually surprisingly well, and Breath of the Wild is just exquisite as all get out. They wouldn't have to change Mario's controls for the most part either. Mario's control in Odyssey is the best he's ever felt as well. Using him and Cappy to make these sick and long jumps, dives, and vaults are always a delight. Not much for Mario's general control scheme could be changed. However, they should do something regarding looking at a couple of moves behind motion controls, because not everyone can access them, and more often than not, it's uncomfortable and unintuitive to pull off. I'd make the spinning cap throw much snappier to execute after making a full circle with the control stick, along with changing the homing cap throw to being mapped to one of the shoulder buttons of your choosing after throwing Cappy. It'd be a pain to have these flexible controls logged off to people who have disabilities or can only play in handheld mode or something and be unable to perform these crazy moves and abilities. That, and it's just uncomfortable, especially with a pro controller. Other gameplay ideas or things to address? I'd like this game to aim for a higher level of difficulty, just like Galaxy 2 did. Lots of us have played a bunch of Odyssey as is, most of us beat the game, lots of us 100%ed it at least once, and one of the most common gripes people have with Odyssey is how easy the game is. Odyssey is by far one of the easier 3D Mario games I've played. I'm almost 100% positive Super Mario Galaxy 2 and Super Mario 3D World gave me bigger trouble in terms of difficulty. A part of this could be because I played the demo of the game for like hours almost every time I went to my local GameStop, if you guys remember when I used to speedrun the demo and get as many moons as possible and got the world record for like a day or two, so there may be some bias having accustomed to the controls before launch, but I do confidently feel the game is very easy across the board. A lot of the moons are out in the open or resort to ground pounding with Cappy, the challenge rooms make platforming a breeze compared to before. Like, rarely did I feel my wits and skill being tested significantly like in past games with Sunshine Secret levels, Galaxy and Galaxy 2's comets, 3D Land and 3D World Special World, etc. I know it's a Mario game and they're not exactly famous for their difficulty first and foremost, but the skill floor and ceiling vary depending on each Mario game, with Odyssey's ceiling being on the lower end of the spectrum. The game was designed to be as accessible as possible, probably for newcomers and people who have never played a Mario game in his or her life because of how easy it is, but Mario games never struggle with accessibility. Everyone knows about Mario. People talk and play his games all the time, between his 2D and 3D games, the most disregarding Mario Kart for a second. You're not really going to struggle making a profit or raking in newcomers to his franchise and sub-series, so there isn't much of a need to dumb down the difficulty for newcomers. The only times I ever felt any sort of increasing challenge and skill test was near the end of the game at both the dark and darker side, specifically the dark side's challenge rooms and the darker side being the endgame's final gauntlet. For example, the dark side's challenge rooms are all retreads of previous challenge rooms you did earlier throughout the game, one of which was a challenge where you'd have to race with the scooter over a series of P-switches and make it to each end before the P-switch's timer runs out. The difference with this and the dark side version is there is no scooter. Your only method of reaching the other side with no tools is by rolling, and I found this out after dying a couple times after testing with regular and long jumps. The timing is surprisingly strict. The darker side as well is for sure one of the hardest challenges in Odyssey, but even then, I felt it was an easy challenge compared to previous games and previous levels. I managed to beat the darker side on my second attempt during my first playthrough. Champions Road and Grandmaster Galaxy, especially the Perfect run gave me a much more difficult time with the way they were designed and the moveset and the restrictions you had to work with. Comments from both Galaxy Games and 3D World's levels throughout most of World's Star, Mushroom, and Flower also gave a more stressful and hard time. What they could do designing Odyssey 2 is come in with the mindset that people picking up this game already played Odyssey 1, so let's give them a bigger difficulty curve, whether through level or world design, platforming, puzzle solving, racing slash speedrunning, etc., and more interesting challenges. Most who pick up a sequel have already played its predecessor. That much is an easy and valid assumption. Not only will it sell well with ease, but you be respectful your target audience by recognizing who's picking up the sequel and designing and making the game worth playing and trying to complete by providing a harder, proper challenge that the first game was surprisingly lacking. The game's easy difficulty is also tied to another issue of Odyssey, specifically regarding the power moons. The number of moons that can be collected in Odyssey is staggering and exponentially massive compared to the number of stars and shine sprites in previous entries, either as a main collectible or a side collectible in 3D World's case. However, there is a case that can be made that there are too many power moons, with a lot of the requirements for these moons undermining its actual value. How many moons in actuality are there that require you to find seeds, walk across the map, plant them, and wait 10 minutes for the moon to pop out? How many moons are just sitting out in plain sight and can be nabbed by simply walking up to them? How many times do you talk to an NPC just to nab a moon? Herding sheep, buying moons in every kingdom store, doing simple quizzes, small and easy minigames like Jump Rope or the Scarecrow Timer Challenge ones, the Goomba stacking ones, the amount of Music Note moons, the number of either visible or invisible ground pound spots, etc. A majority of these kinds of moons, especially the Music Note and Seed ones in particular in my opinion, aren't very good moons. I'm talking like tier 1 difficulty for a lot of these, comparable to talking to Toad for 3 stars in Mario 64, finding Comet medals in Super Mario Galaxy 2, or the blue coins for Mario Sunshine. The game's still fun to me, don't get me wrong, I love how Mario moves and there's a sense of satisfaction of nabbing all these moons, but these and a couple other types of moons feel a tad tedious and basic to keep the player engaged or feel as satisfied or fulfilled as stars and shines of the past. What makes this problem stick out more is the fact that minus the main objective moons, which are mostly boss battle moons I'm referring to, every single moon has the exact same value. Your halfway main objective moons, like each Snow Kingdom main challenge moon, the Bowser Kingdom main moons prior to the fight against Robo Brood, or talking to each New Donk City music player, has the exact same value as the Music Note moons, the Seed Planting moons, the Ground Pound moons, the Captain Toad moons, the Dog Sniffing quote-unquote Metal Detector moons, etc. Collecting 100 coins and being rewarded in doing so felt like an accomplishment and a reward as opposed to buying them all easily after racking up your wallet. The seed planting moons have to be some of the worst ones in the game because of how tedious and how long they take to complete. The sheep herding ones probably more so. In Super Mario Galaxy, Music Note minigames rewarded you with 1-ups often, but because they've scrapped 1-ups, they amount to moons, which is supposed to be the equivalent of a power star, debatably undermining its value. Listen to the soundtrack of the game and pick a song based around a theme because a music toad asked to? Great, here's a moon, walking in a certain pattern because a Koopa asked? Okay, another moon. There's also one in the Wooded Kingdom where you have to capture a coin pouch, find a little sprout in some water, and constantly bash the Y button and shoot 500 coins just to get a moon. Again, bottom tier difficulty in terms of what you gotta do, how easy the moons are, and how there's an unfair concept of value when looking at the rest of the game, not even just past Mario games. It doesn't help either that a lot of these types of moons, and other ones I haven't even mentioned like the Koopa Racing ones, the capture an enemy and bring it to a Bonitor in this one location in the kingdom ones, the find the Bonitor in an NPC ones, etc., constantly repeat and are reused in later kingdoms and even when you revisit certain ones during the post game. Mario games reusing same objective stars and shines is nothing new. Red coins, comets, boss fights, secret courses, etc. have been done before. You could debate it's been an issue for 3D Mario for a while now, but it's something the sub-series is very familiar with. But because of the ridiculous moon count and lack of conceptual value outside of multi-moons, Odyssey repeats same objective moons so much more often than previous 3D Mario games by an exponential margin. It makes a lot of the side moons feel like filler just to stretch the game out, especially during the post-game with the giant moon rocks. This also hurts the game's replayability because of how easy and often they repeat. It gets a little boring after a while. Part of me feels like it's because of the structure the game has. Odyssey, unlike its predecessors, has no hub world in favor of giant, sprawling sandbox worlds, and you don't get kicked out upon collecting a moon to any hub. This structure I'm a fan of, as it keeps the pacing of the game and theme around exploration much more fluid and true to the idea. And though, let's be honest, even with Peach's castle as a hub, if Super Mario 64 had the style of star slash moon progression, the game would even be shorter than it already is. You can 100% Mario 64 in a matter of 6 hours, I'm not even kidding. Not being kicked out of a level would shave even more time. But that still doesn't change the fact that moons have an unfair value system going for them, and the massive amount of them with the number of reused moons debatably tries to hide the fact that Odyssey could be lacking in content regarding the objectives and creativity surrounding them. So how would one tackle this dilemma? Is there a way to separate the value of the plethora of easy filler moons with the main ones? Is the game's moon count too overwhelming for newcomers or veterans on repeat playthroughs? I have one idea that could alleviate this issue. I doubt it'll completely fix everything, but it's guaranteed to adhere to some of these issues. For one, which could be optional, decrease the number of moons. The fact that Odyssey reuses so freaking many of the same moon objectives, and many of them are very basic and simple, can get old relatively quickly. At the very least, no matter the option, you could eliminate the seed planting ones, most of the NPC ones, the ground pound ones, and others of similar stature. We could deal with having a couple hundred less moons compared to 880. Like 500, 600 max feels very well and high enough. The second option, which is the one I personally recommend, is have another moon tier value. There are power moons and multi-moons in Odyssey, similar to power and grand stars from the Galaxy games. Why not keep any side slash filler moons as power moons, add a tier for the singular main objective ones as dual moons, two moons attached to each other, and the boss battle main objective ones as multi-moons, or to make the value system even more fair and visually defined, keep the filler moons as one moon, the singular main objective ones could be the multi-moons instead, and the boss battle main objective ones could cost 5 moons and be aptly dubbed grand moons, like how multi-moons originally were going to be named. This heavily separates the value of the main objective moons and the side moons by a good margin, and providing enough incentive and definition for anyone who feels it's justified to go out of their way to get every moon without feeling a sense of empty value, having most of them amount to the same perception of value. To add on to this, for the postgame, if they feel the need to retry the Moon Rock moon expansion idea, why not let the Moon Rock burst and expand, tying to the actual landscape of the kingdom? For the Cap Kingdom, for example, the Moon Rock would expand and try to mesh with Bonneton's material and makeup and add a big strip of land stretching over the large portion of fog north of where you start in the kingdom. Let those Moon Rocks serve as expanding the kingdom itself, rather than just adding more moons, actually giving a bigger incentive of re-exploring these worlds upon revisiting them in the post-game, as their structure wouldn't be the same as it was upon your first visit. Not only do I feel this will make the post-game feel much more fleshed out and expansive, I feel increasing the main moon values and adding a moon value tier would be a good compromise, but if there's any flaws or holes in these, let me know down below. I'm open to constructive criticism and idea tossing. Other things to expect or want, I'm sure it's fair to expect a decent number of new NPCs. There was a surprisingly good number of new races and subspecies introduced in Odyssey. I'd be happy if they added around like 4 or 5 new ones. Galaxy introduced the Bee Tribe, the Girmos, the Lumas, etc., and Galaxy 2 introduced those birds you race as Mario's attached to a big red bird, and the Whittles, those little wood people. They don't gotta be nuts with new designs and concepts. I'd like them to reuse some of Odyssey's NPCs though, especially the new Donkers. I think it's safe to say the writing will be good too. Like I said, I got flashbacks to Paper Mario and Paper Mario the Thousand Year Door with what a lot of these characters and NPCs had to say. It was really astonishing and quite refreshing to see these bystanders actually have some funny and memorable dialogue. Also, go crazy with the costumes. There were so freaking many in Odyssey, I'd be totally fine if they kept them all in the sequel, along with a whole new slew of costumes. Because here's the thing. There's concept art for the costumes Mario wore, and there's still a bunch they didn't even use. A Pit outfit, a Toadette outfit, a Rapper outfit, a Toad outfit, a Native American Cherokee outfit, a Viking outfit, a Soviet Russian outfit, a Blow Up Wrestler outfit, a Luma outfit, a Sprixy Princess outfit, a Streetworker outfit, an Ice Climbers outfit, a Birthday outfit, an Innocent one, I mean, come on people, a Nutcracker Marcher outfit, a Metal Commando type outfit, casual rapper like Starman attire, a full on ninja outfit, a maid outfit, an anime high school girl outfit with lipstick, a Satan an outfit, there's so many ideas for costumes here, and I know there's even more the development team could pull up. They could give Mario his tennis outfit from Aces, a vampire outfit, a Hawaiian outfit with a coconut bikini and grass skirt, his cat suit from 3D Worlds as a costume, his flying colors from Galaxy, his sunshine attire with the short sleeves and a cute little flood backpack to mimic sunshine even more than his shades and shine sprite vest. Better yet, a Shadow Mario costume, a mime costume, a hobo outfit, costumes resembling other Nintendo characters like Link or Fox. Why not a Princess Peach outfit like what Luigi did in Mario & Luigi Superstar Saga? And maybe a Daisy dress, a Rosalina dress, and a Pauline dress while we're at it. A Bowser Jr. costume, colors and costumes based off other power-ups like the Cloud Flower or Tanuki Leaf, gold and silver Mario, a Tarzan outfit with a wig and loincloth to look more primal than his caveman outfit, a butler outfit, a serial killer outfit where he has dirtied overalls and a hockey mask over his head, a Jamaican outfit with a rainbow beanie and braided hair and everything, a Rockstar outfit with a star tattoo, an alien costume, an Xenon-inspired costume, a witch costume, a shadow siren outfit, a mermaid costume, a train conductor outfit, a nurse outfit, a genie outfit, a normal fairy or tooth fairy outfit. They still have a bunch of different ideas they can make and use regarding new costumes for Mario to wear, along with the unused ones piled on top of the pre-existing ones. The possibilities are limitless with this, I'm telling you. Make the unused ones a reality along with new ones. Maybe you came up with some of these costumes yourself, or maybe there are other outfit ideas you thought I haven't. Let me know down below. Other concepts I'd like to see that they didn't utilize is put Rosalina in the sequel. The 8-bit Easter eggs were cute, but once I saw that Rosalina was planned to be a guitarist in casual attire, I felt so disappointed. They could have expanded on Rosalina by using this musician background as a hobby in her spare time. What if her and Pauline got along and became friends and collaborated in a band together after sharing a brain? They could even go on tour together around the world in New Kingdoms. That's how you get Pauline back in and introduce Rosalina to her. Pauline's famous for her band and her beautiful singing, so she gets to go on a tour of her own. Rosalina's playing guitar in some kingdom somewhere, and they bump into each other, talk, get along, and boom, besties. I want that to happen. They would totally get along as they're both lively, busy women with responsibilities and hobbies they'd likely have more in common with. I do fully expect a sequel to Odyssey to have another vocal song, maybe two if we're lucky. Jump Up Superstar and Break Free Lead the Way are without a doubt some of the best top-tier Mario songs I've heard in a long time. And Odyssey did the soundtrack justice, not just with having a glorious one in of itself, but also for introducing vocal tracks to the mainline games. It would benefit greatly if Mario just kept getting more and more vocal pieces. Also, try not to count boss arenas as kingdoms if they only serve as boss arenas. The Cloud and Ruined Kingdoms mainly served as boss fights against Bowser and the Lord of Lightning, though they added a handful of moons beyond that when the kingdoms themselves amount to essentially a path leading to a big circle. Just make the boss arenas a part of another kingdom, or as basic as an intermission and nothing more beyond the initial boss bout. I'm also hoping the postgame is better, as in Odyssey, it was a tad bit underwhelming in a couple aspects. The Moon Rocks is one thing, and I already stated how that can be improved by actually expanding the kingdoms themselves. The Mushroom Kingdom is a fantastic postgame reward with lots of Easter eggs and nods to Mario 64, along with serving some great extra moons, some not so much. But the Dark and Darker Side are definitely underwhelming by comparison. Yeah, they're gauntlets, the former having some challenge rooms too, but the Dark Side also had a bunch of picture moons, which are also some low tier moons, along with the Darker Side being a quote unquote kingdom, serving as just the final hurdle for the game. Some expected at least one or two more fleshed out kingdoms after the Mushroom Kingdom, and to only be met with two other sides of the moon is reasonably disappointing. And don't forget, as with any Mario game, new enemies, new bosses, new captures, and I would like some of the captures to not just be relegated to single uses or power-ups. Granted, you can't do this with every type of enemy, there's only so much you could do with a Goomba or those onion-looking enemies. But Bowser, for example, had Mario's nimble and high jumps along with claw slashes and fireballs. It was a mixture of Bowser and Mario's best abilities. Why not let some of Mario's strengths and attributes carry into some of his captures along with the captive's abilities to expand Mario's range of options of progress or exploration? The only drawback would probably be limitations of omitting long jumps, dives, and such. And again, I'm not saying do this for every capture as they're limited, but some like the T-Rex, Lakitu, the new Donker with the little RC car, etc., can be expanded a little bit. Odyssey's bosses are good, the Bowser fights and the Ruined Dragon battle are some of the game's highlights, but I feel there could be more ways they can make some new, better bosses, which I'll explain later. To end on this part, can we get a hub world again? Like, pretty please. Mario could still have another Odyssey while jumping in paintings or something at Peach's Castle. If we get Odyssey's map structure again, I won't be that disappointed, but some of us actually do kind of miss having hub worlds. Like, can we have hub worlds back, please? That's essentially most of what I could think of regarding gameplay elements, structure, design, music, concept ideas, and such surrounding that. But what about worlds? What about the story? What about the real main dish of 3D Mario's? What kinds of worlds, themes, characters, other concepts, and other ideas could they pull? Well, there's plenty surrounding those, and I have more character, slash capture, slash scenario ideas as well, so we're not done. One idea I got is regarding the Crazy Cap industry. I feel New Donk City is one of the best worlds in Odyssey because of its structure, its dynamics and themes, the tie-ins with Donkey Kong and Pauline, and how bizarre it was for Mario. Seeing normally proportioned humans alongside Mario, who's also human, is hilarious, and there's a lot to love about the Metro Kingdom. I feel they have to try another city theme as one of the worlds because the idea of Mario in a bustling city with real humans works so well. To diversify and be more original, however, they could stray from the New York theme and try a theme surrounding other worldwide popular cities, such as Paris, London, Bangkok, Singapore, or Dubai, just to name a few. They are visually and culturally different from how New York is. I think it would add just enough flavor to stand out more and keep it distinct and different from New Donk while retaining the city-like atmosphere. To make it stand out even more than that, however, what I'm proposing is we make this new city world the location for the headquarters for Crazy Cap. Since the Crazy Cap industry has shops around the world, it's reasonable it's garnered a large mainstream appeal and worldwide success, similar to the worldwide industries like McDonald's or Amazon. But here's the catch about this world and the theme surrounding it. The owner of Crazy Cap is also the mayor slash president slash owner of the city, but is corrupt and insatiable. He's been able to buy his way to the top of the Crazy Cap business because he's rich, and use the brand to milk in as much money as possible, and convince the citizens of this new city that it's some type of paradise. I'm talking something like One Piece and what Doflamingo did to Dressrosa or something. What makes this crazier is the owner himself. What if the owner of Crazy Cap was none other than Wario, with Waluigi as his assistant manager and or social slash public manager? The Crazy Cap brand is labeled as yellow and purple, just like the Mario Bros. Doppelgangers. With how much the brand has spread, how rich Wario is, and how Odyssey's tried making old, underutilized slash obscure Mario characters relevant in the case of Pauline, it would make total sense that he took over the business. The owner provides less than minimum wage, the workers are put under horrible working conditions because Wario's too stingy to cough up more money than he's willing, and Waluigi enforces that upon acting totalitarian because the both of them are naturally greedy, stingy, and iconic troublemakers. This kind of evil, blind atmosphere and conflict can perfectly serve as the antithesis to New Donk City, where Pauline was viewed as an idol and celebrity, where minus Bowser's interference, the city was bustling with pure joy and admiration for it and Pauline collectively, as Pauline cares a lot for her citizens and city. Wario and Waluigi, on the other hand, don't, because unlike Pauline and Mario, their hearts aren't pure. The only thing set on their mind is power and money, and because they're partners in crime, they feel justified in working together in doing so. What's more is, unlike Pauline prior to Odyssey, Wario and Waluigi are, while also underutilized, very popular and have mainstream appeal already. Giving them an antagonistic spotlight in a main Mario game, while highly unlikely, sure, would be absolutely awesome to see. You could even theme the purple coins of the kingdom after one of the different golden coins you had to collect in Super Mario Land 2, where Wario was the main villain of that game. Upon the two meeting each other, Wario's hatred and spite towards Mario provides them an unpleasant confrontation, and Mario's kicked out of the headquarters, then put under a bad spotlight by him and Waluigi through advertisements and rumors. He could have to go up against some of his workers or robots or something like assassins hunting him would do. They could pull a Mario Sunshine and try to label Mario as some type of criminal because Wario said so, and a few missions and levels with such interactions could lead with Mario infiltrating Crazy Cap HQ, helping the Crazy Cap workers, maybe in some kind of sweatshop factory type situation, releasing them like they're prisoners, or defeating abusive robots or machines, raise people to protest and fight against the way Wario and Waluigi are running the city, and end it on a climax leading to a big boss fight with Wario and Waluigi commandeering a giant mech of some kind, and upon defeat, Wario and Waluigi's secret busts out with either the two of them getting kicked out of Crazy Cap and having to start from zero elsewhere, while this new city will either have a new leader or none at all. Go for a more dramatic approach, basically, or they promise to straighten up up and completely fix their regulations and rules for the city, its people, and its company. While not perfect, as it's along the lines of a drafter concept, and I don't mean to toot my own horn, but this sounds like a genius way to not only make a new city world stand out as the opposite of New Donk City, but to incorporate two beloved Mario characters that aren't as utilized as often as they should, and give them a mainline villain role that would suit them and their character immensely well, while also providing a corrupt, realistic undertone as to what they're doing. They could tie Bowser into it. Bowser could simply supply them with the manpower and machinery to keep their shady practices afloat, as if Bowser wants another wedding, just advertise the hell out of it like it's New Donk City or some other motive. Or they may not even need Bowser or the new main villain to tie into them. They'd be able to fit in either way. Not only this, but after returning the city to its natural, uncontrolled state, make this the introduction of Rosalina as a guitarist at some coffee joint, a pub, out in the street, whatever the place. The city would be perfect for Rosalina to kickstart her hobby slash career as a guitarist, and either here or post-game, you could introduce Pauline is going on a world tour with her band, and they bump into Rosalina here, and the two make a song together, which could potentially serve as the game's second big vocal song. But all this, pretty please, especially on Wario, Waluigi, and Rosalina. Super duper please. Next world on the list, bring back Isle Delfino, can either be a post-game world or serve as the beach world, would probably prefer it as a post-game world. Like I said earlier, Isle Delfino was plastered onto the concept art of the world map in Odyssey, but was completely gone later. What's more is on the Odyssey's globe, people have found texture files for Isle Delfino to be placed on the map, but as you could clearly see on the globe in-game, it's not there. Even if it was an Easter egg of some sort, like Babam Battlefield map on Blue Toad's brochure, they bothered to texture in land for the globe of a supposed kingdom and place that same land on the world map concept, only to scrap it. To add on to this, I don't think there was much of anyone who wasn't expecting Isle Delfino as DLC. Like Breath of the Wild getting DLC, we expected Odyssey to have one or two extra worlds, but we only got costumes, a new minigame, and a super short VR mode. If we didn't get it as DLC, I could bet money we get it for the sequel, because a lot of people not only expect it, but also want it in there. The reason they could do so is much like the Mushroom Kingdom was heavily inspired by Super Mario 64, while significantly restructured and different, they could do the same with Isle Delfino. I don't just mean Delfino Plaza either, I'm talking like the whole island itself. Delfino Plaza would serve as the mainland, and we would be able to gain the option of traveling to other locations throughout Isle Delfino, such as Pina Park, Serena Beach, Bianco Hills, Rico Harbor, etc. And one way you could try to put a twist on it while retaining that classic feel, much like Peach's Castle in Odyssey, is use Bowser Jr. since he was absent in Odyssey. You can make it so Bowser Jr.'s trying his hand at conquering without his father's help, but trying on a landscape he's familiar with so he has less of a chance of messing up. One way you could flesh out the world and justify returning to at least some of the tourist spots on the island is Bowser Jr. could have some assistance by either a couple old bosses Mario fans are familiar with, like Petey Piranha or Goop or Blooper, or have Bowser Jr. boss around the Koopalings. This would serve Bowser Jr.'s character well as a leader and going off the Minions modes in the Mario & Luigi remakes. Imagine being able to rediscover at least half of the landmarks from Sunshine for around 5 to 15 Shine Sprites each. Slightly different structures and designs, replaying a couple old courses and levels, but there'd be a new theme surrounding it with Bowser Jr. trying to take over the tropical paradise. What if Flood joined the police force to help prevent any graffiti incidents, and you could capture him with Cappy and transform into any one of his nozzles in an instant? What if E-Gad was there and debriefed Mario of the situation and came to try and amend some of what he caused, since he was the root of Sunshine's conflict? There's plenty of things you could do with reviving Isle Delfino, and like how the Mushroom Kingdom served to Cater 64 fans, I feel it's fair with Sunshine fans getting their due as well. Speaking of, I can keep going with branching kingdoms and worlds to connect to other Mario games. For instance, we already have an established kingdom in the Mario world since 2003. The Bean Bean Kingdom would be a perfect addition and can be heavily altered to fit the standards of a 3D Mario platformer. You could have bean people and who's as citizens, but like in Superstar Saga and similar to Bowser's Inside Story, you could have an epidemic fall into the kingdom and Mario would be tasked to restore Power Moons as the magic it provides, can also act as medicine that cascades throughout the kingdom, but with the multi-slash-grand moon being tucked away by a sickly, possessed queen being like the boss fight in Superstar Saga. Or you could bring back Hackletta or Fawful and introduce them into the main games, or introduce a new boss-slash-conflict altogether. While the Bean Bean Kingdom may not be a new kingdom, it's only ever been used once, and has a lot of room for alteration and restructuring, much like how New Donk City is technically not a new kingdom either, as that's where the original Donkey Kong took place. This would fall under the very similar pretenses. Same could be said for another kingdom fans would kill to have, the Kingdom of Sarasaland. How I feel about the whole Wario and Crazy Cap ordeal is very similar to Daisy and Sarasaland, because after Super Mario Run and her being playable in Smash, I know lots of fans would kill to see Daisy and her kingdom to appear and become mainstream outside of the spinoffs again. Honestly, I feel Daisy would get about as much love and positivity from fans and players if she got what Pauline got with New Donk. To add on to this, it seems Sarasaland was potentially planned for Odyssey, looking at some concept art here, where the lower right side of the picture has Easter Island heads with mountains behind them, much like the official art for Super Mario Land. So it's very possible that Daisy and Sarasaland could have been planned to be a thing. Even if not, the idea still holds plenty of potential. You could have Sarasaland make up four small kingdoms mixed into one, or if you didn't want to go that far, you can make Sarasaland the desert kingdom with a surprising number of flowers and vegetation to have a Daisy theme of sorts. You could add Tatanga or a new villain causing havoc, Mario saving Sarasaland's people and Daisy herself as well. A Sarasaland comeback could honestly hit a lot of people along a very similar wavelength than New Donk City and Pauline did. Bring back Sarasaland and put Daisy in the main games again. The last kingdom I think they could branch with existing characters is a jungle slash forest kingdom with Donkey Kong in it. Since the only Donkey Kong related references in New Donk, tailored to Donkey Kong himself, are only street names and an 8-bit Donkey Kong, they could also use this opportunity to have DK have his jungle be overrun by Bowser's minions, and with Mario's assistance, the two could try and run them out. Either that or use this opportunity to reintroduce King K. Rool and his Kremlings as Donkey Kong's enemies since his revival in Smash Bros. You could have Donkey Kong and some of his other Kong friends there. You could have Cranky Kong, and he's still bitter towards Mario for the original Donkey Kong arcade games, as Cranky Kong is the original Donkey Kong. There could be some cool things you could do with Donkey Kong in a jungle world. One original kingdom idea, however, is a haunted kingdom. One weird thing to note about Odyssey is it's the first 3D Mario where boos are non-existent. Nope, there's not a single boo in Odyssey, only the Bonitors from the Cap Kingdom. It's really weird when you think about it, so a haunted cemetery or a spooky park or lake or town would be a great theme for it. It may not even have to tie directly into a spooky vibe. It could go for something more desolate and grimmer, like the Ruined Kingdom, except make it an actual kingdom. Destroyed buildings, a last handful of survivors as if apocalyptic. You're on a journey to find whoever destroyed this once beautiful town. Or it could be a home for crooks and bottom feeders like Rogueport from Thousand Year Door. There are nasty thieves and criminals trying to get by with underhanded tactics, and it's a horrible place to live. What would be the icing on the cake, however, is imagine a boss fight where a dragon's the cause of the destruction. But it's not the Lord of Lightning. It's an enemy of the Lord of Lightning who's stronger than him. He returned from Odyssey 1 to form a temporary alliance with Mario and allows him and Cappy to capture him so you control a dragon to fight another dragon. You can't tell me that wouldn't make for a stupidly awesome boss fight, even better than what Odyssey did. That'd be so freaking sick. I'm curious how they plan to interpret Bowser's Castle if they make a sequel, because Odyssey's interpretation being all Japan inspired was an absolute treat. I hope they make another China slash Japan inspired world, because those seem to be some of my favorite themed levels slash worlds with Mario games, looking at Bowser's Kingdom and Hands-On Hall from Super Mario 3D World. What if there was a village where ninjas resided and you had to fight a ninja as a boss of some kind? As for Bowser's Castle itself, I wonder if they try that theme again, or just go the standard castle route, or something completely different. Imagine Bowser's Castle on a landscape that's eerily similar to Hell, in some way, than just fire and lava everywhere and volcanoes. Black rocks, red poles, enemies with little devil horns, and the castle itself is a massive, fancy shade of black and red. Thankfully to me, Bowser's Castle world and levels failed to disappoint, so I'm curious where they go from here. What if they went crazy like in Galaxy and made a giant country made of toys and gadgets and the inhabitants can be living, breathing toys? Toy Time Galaxy or Paper Mario's Toy Box, but it's an actual kingdom. Not only that, they could tie that with an amusement park theme, a Funland kingdom of sorts, a kid's paradise, toys, games, roller coasters, giant balls, happy-go-lucky music playing, but like kids and their boundless energy, the park has become chaotic and frenzied. This idea I built off of some fan art where someone drew Mario in this amusement park-like world in Odyssey, and that honestly could be a really creative and cool idea. There's plenty you could do with toys in an amusement park. You could also expand Rosalina being in Odyssey by having her and some Lumas visit Earth for some special slash secret event where a galaxy or two could come in later in the game, and you visit sandbox galaxies to get a mix of galaxy and Odyssey in there. This, I'm thinking, could be a post-game thing, but you can make some heavy space theme like Space Junk Galaxy or Battle Rock Galaxy gone sandbox. Or you get sent to an alien planet and your job is to explore, find enough moons to escape as there's an alien boss of some kind. They could serve as harder kingdoms and use some galaxy bosses if possible. The last kingdom I could come up with is something food related. Not just any sweet, sweet kingdom with sugary candy and baked goods or something like the Luncheon Kingdom. I'm thinking we make this world breakfast themed. A breakfast kingdom, giant pancakes, bacon, eggs, waffles, sausage, a sea of orange juice or milk, big bowls of cereal. You could have the Volbonans from the Luncheon Kingdom come back, or introduce a race of knives and other silverware, or a race of fruit people or piglets just to make the ironic twist that piglets are making bacon. You could make the boss another bird, just make its origins come from a sour egg and hatched unknowingly or something. Or you could make a brand new magic flying pig boss or something and have him slash her violently protest against the Breakfast Kingdom's customs or something. I don't know, I like the idea of the world and the theme, I'm just struggling for a competent race of inhabitants and the boss, I feel. That's all I could think of when it comes to worlds. I've talked about potentially 10 to 12 with a few conjoined in some manner or not, but there are a few more things I'd like to address. One, they never established why Cappy is the only one of his kind that could capture objects and humans. Tiara and none of the other Bonneters, as far as we know, don't have the same ability. Yet, before Bowsette was a meme almost a year ago, there's concept art of Bowser taking over Peach and Bowsette coming to fruition before we made it a meme. I kinda hope they explore more on that capture mechanic outside of Cappy with Bowser, his hat, and other Bonneters. Imagine if we could capture Peach and actually control and play as her. That would sure be something else, especially if there's some story beats involved with her and Tiara if they want to reuse their dynamic again. Another crazy out there idea. What if they made an entirely new villain for the premise? You think it's Bowser, but they pull some Mario RPG, Paper Mario type stuff, and we get a new villain a quarter of the way through the adventure. Whatever this new villain wants with Peach, or the world, or whatever, Mario and Bowser near the end team up. Bowser allows Mario to capture him again as a last resort, and the final fight boils down to Mario and Bowser as a team, with Bowser captured, like in Odyssey, and it's this big brawl or something. I'd love to see Mario and Bowser join in a dynamic in a main series game, not just the RPGs. And lastly, can we at least have Peach seem grateful and affectionate for Mario at the end of the adventure? The ending of Odyssey, while funny, left a very sour taste in a lot of people's mouths because of Peach rejecting Mario, leaving on the Odyssey without even telling Mario, and kinda just emotionally crushing him and Bowser. Whether a hug, a kiss, a proposal, at least give us a happier ending, please. And I think that covers all my ideas and criticisms and wishes for what they could do for Super Mario Odyssey 2. Sad thing is, a lot of these ideas probably won't even happen, but it was at least fun to dream. Maybe I'll be lucky, who knows. I do believe above all else, we will get a sequel relatively soon, it's just a matter of time. And whatever they have in store, an Odyssey sequel truthfully holds plenty of potential of being a better game than Odyssey in idea, structure, execution, and creativity. What do you think? Do you think there's a good chance of Odyssey 2 happening, or am I just being delusional? Do any of the ideas I've explained suit your fancy, or do you dislike them? Any ideas for characters, worlds, bosses, structure, design, etc. you have that could expand this possibility? Let me know down below. I appreciate you all for watching this very long video, and I look forward to more discussions regarding all things Mario and other Nintendo games. Stay super.